You know how to whistle, don't you, Steve? You just put your lips together and blow.
Prepare to be astonished!
Doing this, welcome to Headline This. We're back, and who would have thought that I'd roll back into the interview format? I'm Stephen Radford, and you're listening to Headline This. The noise in the background is my son. This is life. I'm not going to disguise it. We're doing this raw. We're going to keep it raw. And you know, I enjoyed those days when we listened to Battlestar Galactica podcasts with Ronald D. Moore, and his wife would come in with shopping and they'd have their little conversation on the side when we're, you know, supposed to be talking about Cylons and spaceships and explosions. And it was really cool, you know, and it's great. It adds texture, and I'm not afraid to have a baby come wandering in and make some outlandish loud requests for food and drink. So it's going to happen, folks. So strap on. Strap in and be ready. So why has it taken so long for me to come back with an interview format podcast? Why has it taken over 2 years? I mean, I've been fighting a battle in my head. The one battle is, of course, the realism, the background noise, you know, this is life. We're doing this in our home. We're not in a studio. If we were in a studio, then things would be completely different. It's not so much that it's hard to listen to, which I'm trying to put that into consideration. I'm trying to make sure that listeners. Yeah, we've got crowds of people sitting in an auditorium just listening to an iPod. iPod? Well, I don't just go to MySpace and, no. Okay. Now, Leigh Thorne, who I'm having a conversation with today, by the way, this is the Leigh Thorne episode. I haven't spoken to Leigh ever since we finished college back in 1999. We went our separate ways. And it wasn't until, well, a decade later when I actually did a vanity search on his name and found this wonderful creation of Pyramid Head. A recreation of the Silent Hill character. It's hard to really pinpoint what you call it. I mean, this guy, he's an engineer. He's a costume designer that is less to do with garments and more to do with architecture. The patience that he has for this is incredible. I mean the talent of this guy, the ability to just not only just figure out the build from images alone, but to scale them, to draw them piece by piece like a jigsaw of the night sky. It's impressive. It really is impressive stuff. You can see his build for Pyramid Head and RoboCop online. You can see the progression. There's a lot of progression videos. And you know that it takes months to engineer and create, let alone paint and to also maintain. I mean, these things need maintenance, and it's a lot of work. It's a lot of hours. And to fit it in and have a family, you've got to be impressed. You've got to be impressed for something like this that you could easily just give up and say, okay, well, I'm not going to finish this. But Leigh's not that kind of a guy. Leigh's somebody who really wants to do the work. He wants to do the graph, whether it being short film, whether it be story. I'm impressed by anybody who follows through on projects. And if you don't know Leigh, perhaps this is a chance for you to understand the whole cosplay thing as well, from the inside looking out. I have to admit, I'm not a costume wearer at conventions. I think I'm just far too self-conscious, and I'm also limited as to what I can do. I'm quite a tall person, and I kind of just think, well, who is there? Who is there that I can do that isn't a cliche, you know? When you think of cosplay, you think of those people who wear latex molds on their heads. They glue in a little bit of brown fuzz, and then they wear kitchen utensils in order to embody a half-hearted attempt at a Klingon. You can see Google images for those sidewalk pizzas, but these cosplayers have a craft. They live through the design of their creations, and it's something of a spectacle. They're more about embodying a character that they've come to love. It's incredibly freeing, I can imagine. So that's enough from me. It's time to get into this conversation with Leigh Thorne. And, okay, I'm reckoning with the sound quality. I'm getting there. I'm happy with this one. I am happy. It's quite a long one, so strap in. That's better. No, strap on. That's something else. Strap in. I'm trying hard to reckon with it. And from time to time, we do have a bit of a sound fallout, but I'm not going to disguise it. I left it in there. I didn't edit it out because that's reality, and I think it's beautiful. Reality is something that we need to embrace. Sometimes reality can imitate art, you know? So now let's talk to Leigh Thorne. Yeah.
Well, funny enough, I've been doing a lot of writing recently, mm-hmm. and about to enter a competition, actually. I'm just in talks with someone who's, funny enough, I've got talking to a guy in Cannes, and I sort of stayed in contact with him, and I've had a few people on Twitter and a few of the social media sites trying to get me to sort of pass my script towards them, and I'm petrified of copyright problems.
Oh yeah, we all are. It's terrifying.
I've just reconnected this week, actually, because the people who've proofread the script have said it's amazing and it should be a novel, apparently, and it's 135 pages, which is, you know, a few pages too many, really, the standard.
Yes.
And the problem is I've got here, and where I live, is I keep trying to make short films, but on a small island, people back out. Mm-hmm. And because you're not paying them, everybody wants their name in the credits, but nobody wants to do the work.
That's true.
Everyone wants to see them big names, and they all want to sit there watching at a premiere of their short film or feature film, but nobody will do the graft. And to find a handful of people that will do the graft, and if you're directing and writing something, it's finding someone who will just trust you when you say, look, I need to do a scene like this. This is the way it is. And they go, but it doesn't look right. Don't you direct, don't worry about it. Just let me do that.
You're in Jersey now, right? So your mm-hmm. your film community must be quite small.
Yeah, it is small. I mean, there's small little groups that pop up and have their burst, as it were, mm-hmm. where they get a project on a go and everyone gets interested. But once again, on a small island like this, people don't realise that once you start doing something, it's a long... So to film a 5-minute scene can take 3 days.
That's it, yes.
And this is, and they don't understand that. They think, well, right, well, you've got a guy in a room and he's talking to somebody. Right, well, that's only going to take, I can fit you in between, I can come in and help you between 10 a.m. and 1 p.m.
Yeah.
And you
yeah.
think, well, I need you for a day, and then we might need to reshoot the next day. Because they don't seem to understand simple things like, you know, if there's a piano against a wall, say, mm-hmm. they don't realize that if you're filming from another angle, there is no wall there for the camera crew and the lighting and everything else. You know, you've got to move things around and use your imagination. We don't have sets, you know.
It's never that easy.
Yeah, and then, yeah, so this is what's happened now is mm-hmm. I've got my biggest problem is I can't stop writing. Which is quite interesting because I'm highly dyslexic, and I was told at school that I would never write anything. My teachers said that, you know, you basically I'm a write-off, as it were.
Isn't that just the way back in the 80s and 90s? People just didn't have a clue.
Yeah. It was funny enough, technology is doing it for me because I've got some amazing little things. There's a new add-on actually a Google add-on. I think you can get it for anyone. It's called Grammarly, for Chrome. If you're dyslexic, it's a must-have tool because it helps you in more ways. I managed to do my first after I did the last script. I used Grammarly to completely check it, and it logs all your errors for you and keeps stats on you, and it can see patterns that happen, and it and it can really help you with your writing. So that was fantastic. I was busy told I'd never write anything, and now I find myself in a situation where it's like last night alone. I had a dream last night, and I've got a really good idea for something. I woke up and said to the wife straight away, "I had this amazing dream." Okay, it starred the bird from Resident Evil, which isn't a bad thing. I had this dream, and all these things happened. Which I won't tell you because I'm going to write it all down.
Yeah.
And I said, that sounds like a really good film. And she said, yeah, it does. I went, I can't write that down.
Especially if you get validation from your other half, half asleep in bed. If you get that's a pitch and a half already, so you know it's got to have legs.
Yeah, she didn't throw a pillow at me and tell me to make her a tea. Yeah.
That's good.
But that's the thing. I write shorts, and I was helping other people. Now I've just started writing features just because I can just keep writing. And really go into a world, and
that's it.
And now I've got a couple features sitting around now, and they're sitting on a shelf gathering dust.
Yeah.
And I keep trying to get people on the island to help me. I'm not a producer. It comes down to it. I love to direct. I love to write.
You love to perform.
And I even love to dabble. I love to dabble in the acting.
Yeah, you do.
But if you were to, like in the last few projects, people have all suddenly said, right, Leigh, we'll do some work with you. I say, I need a producer and I can't get one. And they all look to me and go, well, what do we do next? And I'm like, well, actually, that's not my area.
Yeah.
And getting somebody on your side over here that will actually just stick with you and do their producing and get things together, that's impossible. I've had a couple of people who have said, yeah, I'll produce, and I've got a project going, and then they've just stopped producing and stopped helping. So
it just sounds like you're a twin to my experience. This is exactly the same thing that's been going on, and the writing never stops. And I think that's because your creative brain is basically taking over both sides of on the left side and your right side, and I think it's that sense of business, the business side of things. It's very difficult to kind of manage. Because you know it takes a lot of work, and you understand that certain things need to take place in order to get productions going, but you need the person who has that other side of the brain to kind of take all that, so that you can worry about the creative side and they can worry about the management side of it all.
Yeah, no, that's absolutely true.
Mm-hmm.
So what I've done is now I had one of those moments where you know, I follow, like, there's a great Twitter feed on the Pages competition that happens in Hollywood, or in LA. And it's a competition where you enter, it's for new time writers, they enter. And I was desperately trying to get it in for the deadline, but I wanted to make sure that I was trying to knock this script down. I was trying to get the pages down. It was 144 pages, and I was just trying to trim it and trim it and trim it. And
that's hard, man.
I basically went through and just took out any directions in there that were obvious or not needed that the director could worry about, and just get the story.
Yeah, that's
and,
it.
And I got it down to 133 pages, something like that, and 135, is it, whatever it is. And it's just, I've come to the conclusion, I can't get it down any smaller without ruining the story.
Mm-hmm.
And everyone looks, and no one's ever going to make it here, so I'm going to enter it. So I've talked to my contacts, as it were, and who knows what will happen with that. But
it's worth doing, definitely, because I think that you've had ideas, you've worked on a lot of things, as I can see with the Primavera. Is it Primavera?
Yeah,
Pictures.
Did you
write most of those, all of those, or? Were you a part of it?
In Primavera, what it is, most of the writing on Primavera, actually, you'll find is Matt Lamarcon.
Oh, yeah.
From over here. He does a lot of the writing on there. And you'll see there's a lot of films where he's directed there. He loves writing and directing. This is the thing. We're just trying to work on a system where we all get a turn each at the moment.
Well, that's good.
That's another problem with a little small company like we've got, where we're doing a lot of it's non-money making. You know, don't make any money on it.
No, short films you don't. Really?
We enjoy making them. Problem is, we've all pretty much had kids, got married.
That's it. That's and, what happens.
It slows down the process. I mean, to be a really good filmmaker, you've got to be someone that's either divorced or an alcoholic, crazy person who lives in a house on their own. You know.
Yeah, that's
really hard to.
I've actually worked with that person before as well, but they turn out to be just as unreliable as the rest, really.
No, it's hard. Luckily, my wife's very positive. She's not a big fan of reading some of my scripts because the thing about myself is some of the stuff I've written, I've come to a conclusion that I'm getting fed up of trying to write what other people want me to write. So I've started trying to just express myself a little bit more in the side of things that I like. I do like really dark comedies. Yeah. I love Lynch stuff, anything that's challenges the brain and gets you thinking. I don't want to sit for 2 hours watching a film, eat my popcorn and say at the end, oh yeah, that was good. I loved all that CG fighting. It was fantastic. I actually really do like to come away from it and think, I need to see that again.
Yeah,
I like to not understand it the first time.
So you're a Mulholland Drive, Lost Highway, Lynchian.
Yeah.
Dark
Lynch.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah, well, I just, it's not just the darkness of it. It's the world and the stories and the idea that people have to go within themselves to locate a part of themselves to actually really know what's going on around them and to find out really what the world are we living in. There's the picture that everyone knows that's here, but then there's also that realm of what really goes on. Very J.G. Ballard, everything, the house may be a house with a nice family, but really within them walls, that life, the craziness that can go on in there.
Yeah,
what makes them put the tie on? Why does he do his job?
Yeah, it's the fascinating. It's the things in between that people, mainstream audiences can't handle because it's the stuff that they don't like to pay attention to in life in general. So, yeah, it's definitely the more it's the more artistic side of cinema I've always imagined that you were that kind of a person who would go into Lynch eventually, because back in the day, I mean, when I met you, it was the Alien franchise, of course, was our big thing that we had in common. We talked about it every day, I think. And the fascination with certain films like Death and the Maiden, Copycat. Films that were kind of subversive enough, but I don't think back in that time, we didn't really get into Lynch. We didn't really get into the avant-garde filmmaking as much. I think it probably took a few years for that to kind of sink in. I think we were still very new to the ideas of it all. We understood who Hitchcock was. We were loving the idea of Scorsese and all those contemporaries from new wave cinema, but I think for me Lynch came quite late on, and all of a sudden it just changed my world around, and it fascinated me. I think that the Venial Society is kind of reminds me of a kind of a Lynchian nightmare. The tone of that film reminded me of that.
Yeah. Well, this is the thing. I think the reason why is it back when we were at college and stuff.
Yeah.
It was very hard to know basically the only really knowledge you had was what was in the library and around, and I'm not a big reader.
Exactly.
And whatever came,
I don't think anything anybody came up on telly. Yeah. Rarely came up on telly, though. That kind of stuff rarely appeared on the television.
Yeah. The problem was there wasn't a big access to the library, the internet. You know, the internet was a big turning point for me for everything I do right now.
Yes.
Because I can communicate with a very niche market out there for things I like, and there are people which like what I like, and then I can bounce off them a lot more when you can't really do it when you live in a small town and no one's really on the same wavelength.
That's it.
But yeah, the internet really helped me, get hold and see films that I would never see. And and back at college, I mean, things like Death and the Maiden, I've always been a big fan of my Sigourney Weaver films, and I love her as an actress. I think she's incredible. Mm-hmm. And Death and the Maiden, as well as being a fantastic play, was made into this film, which I think a lot of people have never seen it. And for her to be such a big actress, they've never seen that movie. And it is such a powerful performance in there.
It is.
That's one that get me is I love the fact that sometimes you only need two rooms, one room and a really good actor.
Yes.
You know, that'd be a dream come true.
It's the economy of it all, and then the idea of having music as an organic component, as a predator in that movie. The music was as much as a predator as Ben Kingsley was, and it's just the economy of it all. It was beautiful, and I think that was probably the first time I kind of stepped off the wagon of all this mass market rubbish and actually started to go. I think you probably were the person who started me off in the right direction, I think. I think the short time that we spent together in college, those couple of years where we did drama, I view that as an important encounter, definitely.
It definitely was. It's funny. I do have it's strange actually. I've been trying to think back to my college years, and I moved backwards and forwards between Barrow and Boston a couple of times, and I can't seem to put my finger on why and what was going on then. I think a lot of it is due to my family was moving around, and all things were happening during my 16, 17, or whatever age I was. And
crazy times.
Yeah, it is crazy because I can't quite recall exactly when I was where I was and when, and it's all a bit of a jumble between college and Boston College and myself living in the Lakes and Lincolnshire. It was a very strange time for me. That
absolutely.
Yeah, it was very strange. Strange time.
And then afterwards, we kind of went our separate ways, and it seems as though that life just took over, and you were kind of in my mind every so often, especially when I was in Australia and writing or anything like that. There was like flashbacks, and it seemed as though we'd never actually had the opportunity. For some reason, we actually never had the opportunity to just pick up the phone or to check in with each other until late on, until I found Pyramid Head on the internet, and there you were. I was like, okay, I know this guy. And it's not Edward Norton. It's Leigh Thorne.
Say things have changed. I've my hair. I think people might not even recognize me anymore. They'd probably recognize my voice more than my appearance.
Definitely.
The pyramid head and my costumes has been a really strange thing because I was. I think I was the first person on YouTube back in 2007 to make a video on how to make a pyramid head costume, how I would make one. So I basically stuck a camera in front of myself and made a video. Mm-hmm. And it went pretty wild on the net because all the Silent Hill fans out there saw it and saw me, and I get contacted constantly. I mean, it's not a terrible thing, but it's so strange how technically I put a cardboard box on my head, and I'm known for it. I mean, when last time I was at Comic-Con, people were coming up to me like, whoa, it's Black 79.
Yeah, that's it.
And the funny thing about that is that there's, 130,000 people in there. And when you've got people walking up to you and saying, you're Dax, it's really weird.
Because you become known for something you never thought you'd ever be known for. It's... Who would have
building
thought?
Building a cardboard.
But it's more than that. It's more than that. Because I think you... Because you were the first one to probably do the pyramid head costume in such a clear and the presentation was right. You did it in parts. Mm-hmm. You didn't just put it all into one video. You actually separated it all. You documented how you do it. You were doing it every step, and I think that was mm-hmm. that was unheard of at that time. People weren't doing those kind of now everybody's doing them.
Mm-hmm.
You only have to type in Silent Hill and your name comes up. So you know.
Well, this was one of the funniest searches. I think I Instagrammed a picture of it a long time ago. It was along the lines of I was doing a search on what people thought who was Pyramid Head, and obviously in the game story, in the film story, they've changed the character a little bit of the Pyramid Head, and one of the searches that first came up was who was Pyramid Head, Dax 79, and it had me chuckling so much. I took a picture straight away, and I think I've got the picture on Instagram, or it's hidden on there.
Yeah,
it's at the bottom of my thread on my Dax 79 cosplay page somewhere on Facebook. But that made me chuckle.
It absolutely. It works.
And then I also got a great story back from. It was a guy had made, it might be a girl, guy or girl. This is another thing about the way the internet works. I'm in constant communication with people, and I don't know who they are. I don't know what gender. Yes. They're people. They are just the same interest. They're not men, females, then think. They are people of interest, and we all communicate. And, you know, they could be rich millionaire celebrities, or they could be, you know, people... who are living in bedsits somewhere. You never know. And this one person, whoever it was, boy, girl, contacted me with a fantastic story saying that they'd built their pyramid head using my video. And when they were at one of the cons, Mary Elizabeth McGillen and Akira Yakamoto were there doing some sort of thing.
Yeah.
Some sort of probably a top. Mary Elizabeth is the woman who does the vocals, the singing for the Silent Hill games. Mm. And she's also a vocal director of a lot of animes. If it wasn't for her, English dubbed anime in the Western world wouldn't have taken off. She translates it, she directs them, and really basically is a very, very important person in the world of...
Right.
Of Silent Hill and anime. She's fantastic. So she's someone I would like to meet one day. And Akira was there. And basically, they signed someone's helmet, Pyramid Head helmet. And they went, wow, this is really good. Or apparently, she said, this is really good. How'd you make it? And they said, oh, yeah, Dax 79 on YouTube made it. And they pulled up their smartphone and went, this guy here. He showed the video, apparently, or something.
Oh, yeah.
Image video or whatever.
Oh, and, they showed the video, yeah.
Then they contacted me. Yeah, this was around about, I think about 2010-ish. So I was really sort of, wow. Since then, I've actually met Akira and chatted to him. So,
great.
Yeah,
I've
still got to corner Mary Elizabeth, but, you know, I found Akira.
Well, he's going to be inspired by that as well. I mean, to know that somebody out there has put the work in. I mean, it like you say, it's about the graft. It's about putting the work in, and I think that's one thing that that would be an inspiration for them to carry on doing what they do. You know, it's people like you who are able to keep their work alive. So, I think you'll be very flattered by that.
I hope so. So it's funny when you look at the hits the videos have had, the best thing at the moment is YouTube have really sorted out their stats and the dashboard for the user now is incredible. And you can see, you've got to forget about when you do a lot of how-to videos, mm-hmm. you get the stats on how long people watch your videos and which bits they like. You've got to forget that because people pause videos or they download the videos or they loop when they're working on something. So the stats there are completely wrong. But all the other stats basically show that, you know, they used a lot. And it's funny because when I built the helmets and other things I've built, I can see when someone used my videos, even if they don't credit me anywhere or give a call out or contact me, I can tell which one's mine now by how certain bits go together. I'm like, well, I recognize that because I did it.
Just your little piece of DAX 79.
There's little things where you can tell when someone's done the same.
I'm fascinated by your method, though.
Method? Once again, thanks to the internet, Google Images.
But that's it. So
Google Images.
You don't just start making the costume. You start from looking at all the images, and you make a scrapbook. Is that right? You make a scrapbook of all the different sides.
Pretty much. What I do is I try to stay away from anybody else who's made the costume at first. Mm-hmm. And I start with just the costume from the film or game or whatever it is.
Okay.
Start looking at that. Because you don't want to instantly put in errors and things that haven't worked. So I'll start at the core, what I want it to be. And then I'll progress from there. With Pyramid Head, I mean, this is the third helmet that I've made that I'll use now. And he's coming back out again actually next weekend. Mm-hmm. And it's one of those where, it's just got better over the years. I mean, the newest one, I actually used a file from the computer game Silent Hill Downpour. Pyramid Head's in it for a very pretty much a cameo in the game. And what I did was I got hold of a little. It's basically the game file from the computer game. The 3D elements, mm-hmm. and with that, I took this little model, and unfortunately, I couldn't edit this model. If I was to create the file, flat pack it as it were, and print it out on bits of paper so I'd get the shape, it only came out about 2 inches big, I couldn't because the way the file was created. Originally from wherever it was off the net, off the Sand Hill Downpour, I couldn't edit it or make it bigger, so I had to measure it and draw it out, and it was an absolute nightmare to get this file bigger.
So you literally just rescaled it yourself.
Oh, I had to rescale it, and it was just a nightmare. And then the thing is, a lot of people afterwards are asking if I could help them, so I've given the file I found, I've actually put it on my DAX 79 website now, just for anyone to have, and they can go ahead and do whatever they want with it as well. Because the way I see it is, with cosplay, although you know people say mine's one of the best cardboard ones out there, and it's the most easiest to make, etc. The way I see it is, I always give away anything I've made or found, or any hints that I get. I don't keep my secrets. I like to see other people doing the same thing, because I mean time's too short to be holding your secrets on this stuff, and it's nice to know that you help somebody else experience what I'm experiencing right now. So
that's good.
It's really good. So this little file made it bigger, and it was a nightmare, but it was worth it. And people contact me sometimes getting angry. Oh, I can't make the file bigger. I can't edit it. And I say, well, I couldn't either. It's the angles are there. Designs there, you know, this is what I had, I've got, you know, I can't really help you any further. There are a few people out there who get a bit, you know, you think, come on guys, be happy.
Yeah.
There's always somebody that...
Wants you to do half the work for you, for them, so that they can just go ahead and create it. It takes a lot of patience. It takes a lot of patience.
Yeah. Yeah, but this is another thing people don't realize. In a video might be, I tried to make my YouTube videos with costumes about 8 minutes of video. I tried to go for.
Yeah, it's not
they don't realize that 8 minutes it's not real time. RoboCop took, to build that, he was 11 months. And it was pretty much, I was working night shifts. So I'd get my lunch on a night shift was an hour and a half. So it was an hour and a half every night. Then weekends, I would do solid weekends of, maybe sort of 12 hours at a time. And things wouldn't work out. This is another thing people don't realize. If they look carefully in a video, they'll notice things like with RoboCop, his helmet kept changing color. Mm-hmm. But this is because things went wrong. I had to make 3 to 4 helmets because of the first one I made was too small. I made one that was fantastic. And I went away. I came back and the cats had eaten it because I had 2 cats in the house. And EVA foam, which is my favorite material to use.
That's right.
My cats, they love it. They think it. They eat it. They claw it. So I can't leave any of my costumes in the house. The funny thing is, I live in a set of flats which has got a public hallway that goes to each apartment.
Yeah.
And I have a mannequin that lives outside my front door.
Yeah.
And I put my costumes on that. So the people who live upstairs, they have to keep walking past this mannequin and it's constantly changing from different things. Apparently the guy upstairs finds it incredible because when he walks past it, it keeps changing. He's seen the progress.
Yeah. Well, that's good. At least they're supporting you a little bit there.
Yeah. I always get a bit worried because once the costumes start to get in their final stages, and a good example, I had my Isaac Clarke, stood out there. He's now packed up for Comic-Con, ready to go, pretty much. Mm-hmm. But when he stood on the stand, you get a lot of sort of people getting interested around it, and I always get scared that someone's going to nick apart, like the helmet or the plasma cutter. Because at one point, the helmet, I've started off making the helmet out of paper, then I've fiberglassed it, car filler, then I've painted it, added LEDs, all this stuff. And once it's finished, people go, wow, that helmet's cool. And I always get scared I'm going to go out in the hallway one day and it's gone because someone's stolen it. So it's a bit nerve-wracking having it all out there.
So at the moment, you're moving though, right? So is that going to, are things going to be better for you?
Yeah. When I move, I'm going to be moving into we're looking for somewhere that's got a garage or a workshop or a spare room somewhere that will be locked where I can be building something or making a YouTube video and I can lock the door and go back to it and it's all exactly the same place. People don't realize is where I live, I have to actually, everything I've got has to be put in boxes and stored because the cats and my little girl's 5 years old and I can't have scalpels lying around.
That's right.
And the situation is, it takes me an hour just to get prepped.
Yeah.
Then I have to do my work, and then it takes me an hour to put it all away again. Yeah. Sometimes you get everything out, and then something happens, and then you have to put it straight away again, which adds time on. Isaac Clarke was a nightmare to make because I don't know if you've seen the character from Dead Space 2, but he is the smallest little pieces. Yeah, he's got these tiny, tiny little pieces of little panels of all sorts on him. And
yeah, it's almost like you've built him out of pixels. It looks like it's all pixels. The detail is microscopic.
Yeah, and this is the problem. It's these tiny little pieces everywhere. And just trying to put it away every day and put it in and out. So I'm so happy he's in his box right now. I've forgotten to put a switch in one of the hands. I've got a light in a hand that's supposed to turn on and off, and I've forgotten to put a switch in it. And it's like, oh no. So I'm performing next week and I've worked out my performance piece and I've realized I can't turn the lights on and off on one of my hands. I'm like, oh no. So I've got to do that today and I've got to do a little bit of painting. So.
But you'll be all ready for Comic-Con, which will be the 27th to the 29th. Are you there for the whole event?
Whole event. Basically, because I don't get to go to it too often, I go stream and take three costumes, costume each day. A lot of people take one costume for the whole event. But I like to, my day one, Friday, it's quite quiet on a Friday, if you can imagine such a thing in that place. Mm-hmm. And so I take an easy costume, something I can just walk around, you know, James Sutherland.
Familiarize yourself.
Leon, Leon, the movie, Leon.
Yeah, he's one of my favorites.
Easy costumes. Yeah, they're really easy costumes. And you can walk around. People recognize you as a character and they'll take a few snaps. And it's funny because when you're in an easy costume like that, a couple of people take a picture and they come and say hi. The DAX 79 people stop me and say, hey, hi, DAX. Then day two, Saturday, this is the big day at Comic-Con, really. The celebrities are all out and there's a lot going on. Funny enough, the cosplayers or the ones that have the big suits and big costumes, I find that at some times, it's hard to explain, they are getting more attention than the celebrities. And this is really weird thing that's going on at the moment. I was stood next to the Power Rangers and they were doing some autographs and getting pictures taken. And I had more photographers around me as Pyramid Head than the Power Rangers had doing their thing. And this was really, this is strange because I'd never seen it before like that.
I think it's a change, though. I think what's happening is that people are finding that the celebrity thing is probably not as accessible as the cosplayers. And I think cosplayers are there's a community that's been built now. It's a firm community. Mm-hmm. Everybody wants to kind of I think they just want to be more sociable with each other than they would be with celebrities. Mm-hmm. I think it's easier to gravitate towards that, I think.
Yeah, it's a strange. It's just weird. You know, like when I was it was the same Saturday actually. The celebrity Emily Booth, who does the Horror Channel and she does some films, she was doing some sign-ins, and you know, she's there charging what 15 quid a signature, whatever she was doing, and she spotted Pyramid. And she literally pounced over her table, ran around, and was like, "You're my favorite horror character. Can I get a picture for my Twitter?"
Brilliant.
And I was like, "Yeah, okay." So she gets a picture, and then she turns to her camera guy and says, "Oh, can we just do a quick thing for the Horror Channel?" And I'm just stood there holding my great knife, and she's talking away, doing whatever she did, and then she's like, "Thanks," and off she went. And this funny thing is when the celebrities are going over to the guys, it's technically, once again, the way I find it funny is it's technically a piece of cardboard. Cardboard box.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But then,
isn't
that the kind of like the encapsulates how you know, you feel as though it's this big artificial thing that you're just wearing, but in a way that's kind of what celebrity is. It's not a real entity itself, mm-hmm. being a celebrity. So yeah. that there is such a strong similarity to the two. But then people are seeing a finished piece. They're seeing a lot of work done into it. You're seeing all the insides. It's like a film. You've done this film for months and you've been looking at all the shots. You've been exhausted making it. You're sick and tired of seeing that one shot where you lift the arm up and then, whatever. And you see it for what it is. But for everybody else, it's something that's magical that's coming out of their screen or walking along the promenade with all these big shiny flashy bits coming out. And I think this new one, the Isaac costume, is... It just looks like it should be in a film. It looks like it should be somewhere that's not, you know, there. And it's a magical thing.
Yeah, when you wear the costumes, what is very funny is the reactions of people.
Yeah.
So obviously I can see out and they can't see Pyramid Head, say, and even Isaac, actually.
Exactly.
I'm a big fan of the costumes with helmets. I love being inside it. I also think that this is something I could do for the rest of my life, as in I could be 91 years old inside a Master Chief costume and I would be Master Chief. I wouldn't be an old guy.
Yeah.
And it's what I like the idea that I can hide inside them, and it is very good fun. It's
infectious.
Very strange how, and also, yeah, and also it's strange that people come up to your character, and they talk to it as if it's the character. They talk to you as if you are actually that character.
Exactly.
And you know, it's very good to, you can tell the difference between the people who built them, because there's people who build them because they love them.
Yes.
The characters. There's people that build them because they want a good in them. And then there's the models, and basically, I mean, the way I see it, what I think is hilarious is there's a lot of cosplay girls. This is the problem with cosplay at the moment, is a guy can spend a lot of his life building something and putting a lot of love in it.
Okay.
If I was a girl in a bikini doing it, I would be getting a lot more help and attention. And just sometimes the help, you know, somebody, you know, giving away some free supplies. You know, I've known girls, they can go up to a stand, say a Comic Con and something, and say, I'd love to use your product for something. And they'll be like, oh, here's a product. You can have some samples and take this away. And can you just make sure you credit us in your videos? If I went up to them and said that, they'd be like, no.
Yeah, that's kind of a thing, isn't it? That's that girls always get free drinks. It's as simple as that.
Yep. The guys have to work harder. But you can tell sometimes, if you look at some cosplayer girls, you look at their hands, if they've got wrecked nails, cut fingers,
calluses,
and glue gun burns down them, she has actually worked on her costume.
If
she's got perfect hands, she hasn't made that costume. Her boyfriend's made it. Or it's been supplied to her. A lot of people, they buy costumes or get commissions, and then they pretend they've made them, which makes, say, when you enter a competition, you've got to have all your proof that you've made it.
Yeah.
There's a lot more than just turn up a con and doing a masquerade. There's a whole process behind getting onto that stage before you actually get on the stage.
And so it's kind of oversaturated in that kind of in the lack of designers that are being authentic designers, and you'd like to see more of it being upfront and honest. But I guess if there's an easy way out for people to get the glory, then they're always going to take it. But I think that the work certainly shows that what you do is that people will look at you and think, well, you have put work in that. And I think that you probably don't hear it enough, because, you know, like you say, seems to be the bikini wearers or the girls who are doing the Tomb Raider again that get all the attention.
Yeah, Tomb Raider, Lollipop Chainsaw. Yeah.
And it seems to be that, but that's just because glamour is one of those things, and I think it's a separate thing. I don't think you can actually group them together for what you do as to what they do. I think that what they do is just, it's just a different league. I think you're a designer. You're a fabricator. You go from the source and you use, I mean, you're using these sheets, these play mat sheets. That's pretty much the kind of materials that you use. I've never looked at another piece of those of that foam in the same way since I've seen you using it. Because I look at it and I think that could be something from Pacific Rim. This could be something from Battlestar Galactica. And I'm like, no, it's just a mat. But, you know, you it takes a lot of imagination. And I think that if you're coming from that you're in a higher league. They have to really be able to work hard to attain that level, I think. And I think you're doing a tremendous service to the cosplay community.
Oh, I hope so.
I think so.
I'd like to think that you know, they're recognizing me out there. It's just art, really.
It's a skill. I mean, it is a skill.
I've always liked to draw, and I've always liked to do my arts. And
yes.
The thing about this, and which is a bit funny, I love filmmaking, but I've got to rely on people. Good thing about cosplay is I don't have to rely on anybody.
That's it.
Nobody.
Yes.
And I can just do my thing. If it goes wrong, I've learned something.
That's true.
And that's a big thing about it. I learn constantly. I mean, Isaac, when you get judged at Comic-Con, there's a stage where the judges take you into a room, and the three judges or whoever will basically scrutinize your costume. They'll walk around it, mm-hmm. they'll poke it, prod it, they'll ask you questions and basically just rip the thing apart, as it were. Just they want to know everything about it. And, you know, with Isaac, there's this, I've actually used so many different methods, because I'd get to a point where I think, I don't know how to do that. How am I supposed to do that? And I've been looking at my phone. I've got boxes of, I think my wife hates them. I've got boxes of materials. It's just stuff, you know.
Yeah.
If I were throwing away a yogurt pot, I don't want to throw it away until I've looked at it and thought, what is that?
Yeah, my wife's the same. My wife's the same with her jewelry and craft making and anything like that. You don't throw anything away because you never know.
Yeah, and this is it. As I'm looking forward to my move, I'm going to have I've decided I'm going to have plastic containers, and in these containers are going to be shapes, because I need shapes at times. I keep contemplating going down the 3D printer route at times, but then I start to think, then that's cheating in a way. You know, anyone can 3D print. I mean, I've got all the files put together to build an Iron Man suit, and I've not sat there and started 3D printing one yet, because I keep thinking anyone can 3D print a costume and then magnetize it to themselves.
Yeah.
And there's something about sitting there with a scalpel and foam, cutting it, looking at it, heating it up, bending it, and going, yeah, that looks like the part.
It's the difference. It's the difference between being a cook in a kitchen and a Michelin chef, basically. You're somebody who works with the raw ingredients, and you know, who is willing to get the blades out, to do the chopping, to get all the crushing, to all the slicing, to like you say, get the glue on your fingers, to get the cuts. You know, I mean, you probably shredded your hands a few times on a scalpel. You know, it's easily done. With cooks, they just want to get the ingredients out of the pack, just peel it off and pour it on, and then stick it in the oven and walk away. And that's not, you know, that's not art. That's not art. That's the difference between being a chef and a cook, I think. And it's the same kind of thing as what you're talking about.
Yeah, it's the little details.
Yeah,
sometimes.
And you know you've done that detail. Yeah, you know you've done that. Mm-hmm.
Well, this with Isaac, I'm very excited to take him out onto the arena floor, as it were.
Yeah.
I'm very excited to take him on stage, actually, because I've thought ahead where I want the lights to complement the stage and the environment, and I've basically. I don't know. Did you ever see the RoboCop performance piece that I put online?
There was the masquerade, I think I saw, and I've seen a few videos. I've found a few videos as well that were on Twitter that weren't from you, from other people with you in there. And yeah, there's a yeah. It looks exciting. It looks exciting.
Yeah. Well, this is the thing is, you basically you're supposed to stick to the rules. A lot of people, I guess, don't. But you're supposed to have 1 minute 40, 1 minute 45 to basically show the piece off and try. And basically, you've got to make a performance, a story, 1 minute 40 that shows off your costume. And what I love doing, and I've done the same for Isaac, is the same as that RoboCop, is where I've basically taken the film, or in that case, the game, found. Made a story out of bits of the game, struck film, whichever one you look at. I'm using good old Premiere, bang it in Premiere, edit it together like it's a little 1 minute 40 film, and then take away the visuals, keep it as an MP3, and then I basically walk around on the stage in the costume and show it off, and Yeah, it's just some. It's just even putting the performance piece together is good fun. But you've obviously, it's strange. I put it on my iPod and I listen to it on repeat. And I think I've listened to my 1:40 so many times. And you start thinking, oh, have I learnt it? Do I know what I'm going to do? And then, you know, when you're queuing to go on the stage, you're like, oh, right, do I know what I'm doing? And then as soon as the curtain's open, you're off.
Those are the butterflies and nerves that kind of overshadow thing. But I think it just protects you. It's like the lid. It just puts a lid on the performance. Mm-hmm. It puts a lid on what you have to do for a moment, because there's a moment before you go out where your brain needs to just clear. And it's scary because you're thinking, oh my God, I don't remember anything. But what it is, it's your mind is just preparing for you, because you know how important it is. Your brain knows how important it is. And for some reason, it just protects you. And then the curtains open and all of a sudden it just lifts the lid and you're off.
Yeah, well, it's funny because the queue, basic Comic-Con, you queue for everything. You queue for the toilet, you queue for money, you queue for food, you queue. It's a part of Comic-Con.
Yeah.
But the queue backstage before you go on stage is an amazing place, because all the people there have all been through the same process as you.
Yes.
And you're all there. And I don't think anybody in that queue is there to win. Now, there was a documentary struck reality show called Heroes of Cosplay.
Yeah.
That Yaya Han. And it was basically shredded. The Sci-Fi Channel made it, and the cosplay community was furious over it. I still watch it, actually, because I enjoy watching it, just because it's fun to see people doing the same thing. But yeah, it's so staged, as it were. It's a bit cheesy. But I don't think anybody in that queue is queuing to win. And that is one of the most amazing feelings back there, is you're not really competing. I mean, when RoboCop won in 2014, when they were calling for me to come up on the stage, I was actually busy chatting to another cosplayer about how good their face mask was. And then I got prodded and told, you've got to get out there. And I'm like, why? And they're like, you won. Like, what do you mean you've won? You've won. Oh, right, okay. I'll just try and work out how to get up these steps and then walk out on stage. And
yeah.
And I think everyone out there, it's an amazing thing that even now I'm going back. Some people will say I'm going back to hold my title because I missed out in 2015 due to where I could not get there. So I'm going back now, and people from Jersey, because it was the first person to ever win a masquerade from Jersey. People here are like, right, you're going back to hold the title for Jersey, yeah. And I'm like, well, no, I'm going over to have some fun, actually.
But that's a good way of thinking about it. I mean, it's easier. The pressure's off. I mean, you've got enough pressure as it is to remember everything, to know that you've got everything, that you're taking everything over there, and then also you've got to do this performance. You know, it's a lot to think about already, so adding competition to it kind of makes it all a bit messy.
Yeah, it's just, I'm saying, I'd like to be recognised, you know. The way I see it is going up on that stage and showing off my work, I never know what's going to come of any of it. I mean, I have been invited, I think my Halo suit back in 2012, I was invited to a computer game launch in London, where they wanted me to walk around in my Halo Noble 6 suit while for half of the night, and then the other half of the night I would get to, party with whoever was there. That all kind of fell through because they asked me at such a short notice. they asked me, and I was like, I couldn't get off the island. I just couldn't get away. An event happened last year abroad. Again, once I was asked, would I go over and show off my new costume, which would have been Isaac. I would have sped it up. But again, if you get asked a little too late, it's very hard to get off and show off. But it shows that people like what I was doing. So
yes.
I don't really know what's going to happen in the long run. I don't know. It's watch this dead space, as it were. I have no idea where these suits are going and what I'm going to end up doing with them.
I can imagine Is your writing in any way kind of influenced by the cosplay thing? Is there a connection? Are you writing characters that could possibly be created by yourself, or yeah. Are they just completely separate worlds?
It's two separate worlds because my costumes are copies in a way. I take what other people made. I mean, I would love to get my hands on an actual suit. I mean, they had an auction selling props, Pacific Rim, and when the auction went up, I basically screen grabbed every image I could possibly get of the Riley Beckett suit, because I really want to make a Pacific Rim American Drive suit.
Yeah,
I really want to make one.
One of your ambitions, to get that done.
Yeah, it all fell through because the problem is I wanted. The thing about Pacific Rim cosplay is it would be my first two-person cosplay. I need to do it. It needs to be a duo to wear the white suits and do a Jaeger performance piece on stage, which is my dream performance at the moment. I really want to do a scene where the Beckett brothers walk on stage together in sync.
Get into the suit.
Their sides.
That's a huge suit, man.
Stage.
Well, you know, not to the scale of what you saw in the film, right?
Not the 50 diesel engines per strand. No, that's not the Jaeger itself, but the drive suits inside.
Drive suits, yeah.
But the idea of the two characters walking out on stage, one left, one right, and in sync, perfectly in sync, like in the film, and doing a performance piece I just think that would be amazing, but I'd need somebody. I mean, there's a guy on the island here who he does cosplay. There's actually a few cosplayers on the island. They have popped up, and there's a girl on the island. I can't remember her. The thing is, you use aliases. I mean, I'm Dax79. Then there's Matt's BlueJam77 and. Oh, I've forgotten her username. She also has built a Isaac Clarke from Dead Space 1. And it was really funny because she was building hers at the same time I was building mine last year. And that's kind of how we found each other on Facebook, because she was building the same suit as me. And it's like, oh, she's in the Channel Islands, works in town. And there's a few people
who want
to do Isaac. Mm. But I've spoken to her once, but you know, you don't need to see people. The problem about cosplayers are they're usually hiding away in dark rooms. They're not out and about and walking around.
I was gonna use the word geeks, but that's not even right. The last to actually leave the basement. It's not really a basement thing, though. It's something that you do in order to bring out to the world as a social thing. So it's quite a conflict of character for some people, I think.
But the thing is, I think you'll find that some cosplayers are really shy people.
Yeah.
It's usually the bigger the suit and the more hidden away they are inside, you find they're quite shy people.
The more confident they are.
Yeah. There's the one cosplayer that I find hilarious, actually, Kenny Cosplay. I've kind of met him once at Comic-Con, and he's quite well-known on the net, and he's a character and a half. I watch his builds online and think he's really funny. He builds them because he enjoys building them. Sometimes they completely flop. Sometimes they're completely successful. He's a great one to watch online the not celebrities, but they're kind of real people.
They're known
having a good time doing it.
They're all known within a community. It's very community driven. It's like comedians all know each other, chefs know each other, and cosplayers really do get to know each other.
Yeah, I made a lot of friends in 2014. I still talk to them all now. In fact, you know, it's a great community, and it's absolutely it's just
you
a
also
great
know
community.
You remember Matt Fittis as well. I mean, he was with us during the drama years in Boston College. He's he cosplays all of the time. He has the one character, of course, Freddy Krueger. Yeah, I'm not too sure if he'll be doing the London circuit. I'm not sure, but it's possible that he will.
He does actually. Yeah, he does. He reached out to me on good old Facebook and said, "Me," and I said, "Oh, yeah, I'm a And cosplayers all seem to get known for certain costumes. He's always known as his Freddy Krueger. I'm always known as the Pyramid Head. You know, it's funny how you get known for certain suits.
Do you know who my costume is? My costume when I've been to Manchester Comic Con, I am the uncomfortable guy who is wearing a jacket, who looks too hot and looks very anxious about being around so many people. That's my character. I'm getting there. I'm gonna keep going, and hopefully one day I will actually roll up in a costume, and we'll see how that goes.
Yeah, it's funny because my wife's never been to a con, and she I don't think she understands how much I need to be there in a costume, because she was saying, well, let's fly over in October, and we'll just go and walk around it. And I was like, I kind of feel out of place not having something on. I feel like I've got to be wearing a costume.
It's like going up in a spaceship without having a suit to get out and do a moonwalk with. You know, it's like, well, I've come all this way. I really need to be out there looking out at the world in a different way. And I think I can understand that. I mean, I think it's I'm far more comfortable just walking up to all the artists at the tables and just asking them questions and talking to them than I am than I probably would be walking around in a costume. But I think that one day I'd like to figure out what that costume would be, but my wife's the same thing though. She would just be a lot happy just walking around, looking at the stalls, looking at all the things, and she probably was, well, you don't need to get dressed up, you're fine.
Yeah, I think what it is, you're gonna find. I always say this to a lot of people, contact me and say, who should I cosplay as? And this is another thing they always put on Facebook, in forums. They put a picture of himself and say, who should I cosplay?
Yeah.
And I always say, who you need to cosplay, who's in your heart, who you really can, who you really feel like. You've got to...
It's self-exploration.
You don't pick something. At the end of the day, it's going to take you a year to build, say, if you build an armor. You don't want to build something you're not in love with. You've got to really want to be that, to build it, and you really want to. So, and it doesn't matter if you don't look like the person. It doesn't matter about who you look like and what you are. In some cases, it doesn't even matter if you're a boy or a girl. Just pick something that you really feel like you'll be comfortable and confident walking around in. Because there's also the fact that if you're at con, people are going to confront you with all the questions about the character. And some people will start treating you like the character. And if you don't know the answer...
Yeah. You've got to really feel it in order to be it. Otherwise, what's the point? Yeah, you don't want to just ask somebody. I can imagine that, because, you know, some people just don't know what to dress themselves as, because they if you just go to enough conventions, you kind of get an idea of you know, they're probably afraid of being the same person, you know, appearing in the same costume as somebody else. Like, you know, you always get about 5 Harlequins. And you're bound to get a lot of I can't think of any female characters
now. That's one of the coolest things, actually, when you do find someone in the same costume as you. And I think that's different. There's cosplayers and there's people in costumes.
Yes.
There's fancy dress and there's cosplay.
That's a big difference,
You can fancy dress anything you want, but if you're going to cosplay it, it's when you take on the character and have a bit of... You find other people. One of my subscribers on YouTube built a Pyramid Head, and we bumped into each other at Comic-Con, and he was like, wow, and we're both in... It was funny because he was wearing his costume, I was wearing mine, and we got some pictures together and had a really good laugh over the whole thing.
The spirit is different.
Yeah, it's incredible. You know, it's people who have taken characters and done a really, you know, and actually, you know, they love the character, and they, they're the best ones. I mean, I find some of the most incredible costumes. See, I don't play World of Warcraft.
Yeah.
I don't know World of Warcraft because I've never played it. I just don't have time to play it. I'd love to play it, but I don't have time to play it. But
yeah.
I think the World of Warcraft costumes are some of the best out there because of all the details and all the stuff that's, you know, how incredible they are. And the first sort of World of Warcraft costumes I saw properly, there's a cosplayer, actually, there's a girl, can I pronounce it, a Kaldori cosplayer. So a girl that, and I met her at Comic-Con, and she won Best in Show. She won like the major, the big prize. And seeing her costume that she'd done, and all the work and the lights and the paint, body paints, used expanding foam to make different objects and items, the sewing, the details. And I was like, this is incredible, you know, World of Warcraft. And then you see some others in World of Warcraft as well. It's just fantastic stuff. So,
it's a real art exhibition. And I think that it's so good that there's so many people bringing it to light now. And I think with the internet, there are now official magazines for cosplay. There's so much out there, and I think it's a great, not just a community, but it's a great industry, a potential industry. Yeah. There, it's really good. But as long as you've got that, you're not you're letting the writing just happen, and anything that happens towards making films will kind of come as and when everybody's ready and children have actually grown up. And
well, it's the thing. I think with writing at the moment, I need to. I'll keep writing.
Yes.
Yeah, that's what I always do. It. I'm using. Really good. So at first, it was trying to find a good system to write on.
Yeah.
I was using Final Draft. The problem was I'm jumping between laptops and computers. And say I'm at work and I get a half an hour break, I want to write straight away. So I started using Celtics.
Yeah, that's what I use.
Started using their free system on there, which I've got to say I wish they'd stop doing updates with it.
Yeah.
As a writer, you only need the basics. You don't need bells and whistles. You need to, the format needs to be right,
yes.
And you just need it to run smoothly. When they do updates by moving things around or moving my post-it notes, they added a post-it note system on it, which I use a lot now when I'm writing.
Yes.
But then I thought, I love Silent Hill, big Silent Hill fan, and I know the comics, I know the games, I know the films.
Yes.
I know everything about it. And I thought, after watching Silent Hill Revelation, which was an abomination of a film compared to, you know, when you've got the games, when you've got that much story, games, good actors, directors, and all this stuff, you've got everything you possibly need to make something amazing. And then you somehow make a film like that. You think, what will happen?
It's amazing.
So I thought, right,
it's amazing how people can mess it up, and we've had discussions about that on another podcast. But yeah, so you were thinking of.
So when I was thinking, right, I can't diss the writers and directors until I've given it a shot myself. So
yes.
I was a bit angry. I was pretty furious with what they'd done with the collection. So I decided, with my knowledge of everything, could I write something better that would be a film?
So
I've been doing as a little side project, and this is the best thing about this website, is the fact that I can just log on anywhere and do half an hour, 15 minutes, and log off. And I'm 85 pages through it now at the moment. I'm sort of coming to my conclusions in there. I've put some new characters in. and I've kept some of the old characters in, and I've taken the films that we know and the games, mixed it together to come to a conclusion that it's all, you know, it all makes sense. And I think it's actually really looking quite good. So once I've finished it, there's a guy actually over in Canada who I got talking to online because of Silent Hill and cosplay. He's called his username Silent Nerd. I'll never forget that username. And I sent him a bit of the script when I first started writing it. Since then, it's completely changed. So if he's got that or has read that, he can actually put that in the bin. But what I'm going to do is, once I've finished it and it's proofread and it's all done, I'm going to send it over to him and let him have a read. And if he comes back and goes, that's really good, then I can then finally turn around and say for a fact that the people that made Sand Hill Revelation need shooting.
That's the validation you need. Would you take it any further than that, or is this purely a vanity project, a pleasure project for you? Would you take it further?
It's a pleasure project, but I wouldn't know what to do with it.
Yes.
You know, there's one thing writing your own material, but I know for a fact that there's so many copyright. I don't know if copyright is what gets on my nerves, actually.
Yeah,
I'm always
that's true.
Scared of sending things away and it getting inspiring someone to make their film. I've heard that a lot. So
yeah.
When I was at Cannes, so many people that I sent a script to so-and-so, the film came out very much like it, and they were inspired by my story. When people keep asking me about things I do, I say, well, I do this, and do it. They want to see stuff. And funny enough, that's why I've just recently I put together my own little website, dax79.com, because it was getting really hard to direct people to all these different locations for stuff. And it's slowly going to, it looks like turning into it's like a little hub where I can put stuff, and then I can now direct people to one place. And then there is their filmmaking section where I have a scripts tab with nothing in there, because I will put something there at some point.
Yeah.
I also don't know if I should. I keep thinking, should I just put a random? I was thinking of putting a script out in short.
Yeah.
And then
to showcase what you can
do.
Well,
I was putting a script there and asking people to make it in different. To see other people making it from different places. You know, I don't know what I'm doing.
I know exactly what you're thinking. I thought about it myself because of Amazon and because of all the possibilities of publication. I've written a play. I've written a short sketch, which I really wanted Sarah Silverman to do. Like, that's going to happen. The play.
You never know with Sarah Silverman. She's
reachable.
She's actually fantastic. You can tweet her quite easily, actually.
But I ought to let you read it anyway, because it's only a 7-minute thing, but it's right up her street, right up her alley, if you know what I mean. not to take that out of context, but you know, the idea of putting stuff out there on a page for people to read, I think it's important to have tidbits, to have little bits for people to look at. But it's. Yeah, like you say, you could publish something as a book, of plays or a book of screenplays. I mean, nobody's doing that. Nobody's actually creating books of short film scripts and saying, okay, whoever's out there, just go make it. Just credit me however you want to credit me, but just go make these scripts realized. I don't think I've seen that as a publication yet, but I'm kind of wondering if it's worth exploring.
Hello?
Have I lost you? Oh. Well, I didn't expect that. That was, have I lost you? Oh. That's odd. I can do this. Oh, man. Okay, I can find him.
person you're trying to call is not available right now.
Oh, no.
If you'd like to leave a voice message, please speak after the tone and hang up when you're done.
I don't think I can leave a voice message. I hate leaving voice messages. God damn it. Okay, so how is the interview going, guys? I'd like to, while he's actually waiting to call back, I'd like to let you know that he's available at dax79.com. That's dax79.com. And you can contact him through Facebook as well, for the Facebook tag of dax79cosplay. I'm going to keep trying him again, but he's a good guy, Leigh, and it sounds like the writing thing. I think we're literally just the same person, just in a different island. Try again.
The person you're trying to call is not available. If you'd like.
I'm just going to pause this 1 second. Hello.
Hello. Yeah, someone phoned my phone.
Oh, yes.
And booted you out.
Booted me out. I was making a point, and then I got booted. Yeah. Maybe was that a divine intervention or something? Who knows?
So what were you saying?
I think I was saying about getting short films published in a book, and then saying to people out there, just go make these, credit me, and then just go make them. You know, I want you to see what you can do.
Oh. Like royalty-free music, royalty-free scripts.
Well, yeah, but then you really want to actually be, you know that nobody's going to be out there who will credit you. They'll just take it and just change it and do whatever they want to do with it. So it's a double-edged sword. You've got to be the creator, really, in order to get stuff out these days.
Yeah, well, this thing, with this this one that I've... This script that I've just done, this feature.
Yes.
It's science fiction. But what I've tried to go down the route is it's all very plausible, you know. I've taken stuff and I've twisted stuff in a slight way where it's totally plausible, yet not plausible at all.
That's the best science fiction.
Like, you know,
yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I think it'd get people thinking. And it's one of those. I'm just going to gamble with this one. I wrote it knowing that I was going to gamble with it. Originally, it was supposed to be a short film.
Yes.
And as I started writing it, it was like, this is too good. I've got to keep going. And I'm one of these writers where I start off with an idea and I start writing it and I picture it in my head and I make a film as I go along. I don't write beginning, middles, and ends. I don't have... an ending or a synopsis. I imagine it as I'm writing. I'm a slow writer. I don't type fast, which is better, I think, because I can enjoy where it's going.
If you think about it, years ago, before computers, people used to type stories out. So absorbing your film, I think, for people like Orson Welles and Francis Ford Coppola, and any of those writers, they took their time, and I think that's something that's yeah, I think that's a part of it, part of the experience.
I think once I first finished it, I think I've done 5 passes on it altogether.
Yeah,
and it's a nice. It's all kind of, you get to the end of it, and even now when I get to the end, when I'm doing a pass on it and just simply reading through it, I get to the end of it and I always get a little tingle on my arms. It sounds funny. It's tied in a nice little bow, but it's also got so many little things that could make a sequel. It's like I'm quite happy with it, actually. It's like, I'm gonna gamble with it. I've reached out to, I missed the deadline for the competition that I wanted it for, and then seeing my online buddies at Cannes made me think, you know what, I think. I saw a thing somewhere about the people who don't gamble are the people who will never succeed or something like that. When Venial was made, it was made deliberately because I had a feature film as well called Eloquence, which was set in a very similar atmosphere. And the idea was this 10-minute short would, if anyone said, could you make a feature film?
It's a platform.
Mm-hmm. I had one guy very interested with Eloquence. He contacted me a couple of times. All of his stuff said LA. It all looked very positive. He asked if I'd just send the script to him. Uh-huh. And I got a bit worried about it. Yeah, exactly. I got really worried about it. And I then started looking at his copywriting. I had difficulties working out. I joined a company called Future Copyright or something. They've yes. now gone completely, along with any documentation showing that my scripts are, I get worried yeah. about them. With Eloquence, it was like I ummed and erred and faffed around, and then I lost that window of opportunity. And it, in some ways, I don't know, did I lose a window of opportunity, or did I save a script that never going to get made? I don't know. It was like... That's one thing that's always made me think, I don't know, that could have been something. Then I might have been ripped off. I might have been ripped off and been angry. I might have got it made and been angry. I might not have got it made and angry. So
I think the world of the writer is generally basically it's in that zone, and success is one of those things that you kind of you just don't expect to happen. You know, I think you just kind of operate in a system of, well, you know, you write that, you let it go, you write that, you let it go, and it's very hard to do that. It's very hard.
Well, yeah, you spent, you know, for the one I've just done, it took me, you know, with my slow writing to get it where it is now, it probably took a year to write, edit. You know, it's a year to write a film, and to know it's sitting there. Everyone who's read it loves it.
Yes.
And you just know that if the right person got their hands on it, it'd be great. And the right, you know, it's just such. And then Sharknadoes are getting made every 5 minutes.
Yeah, I know, but that's the frustrating thing, because those are people who actually have the connections in the industry. They are on the inside, and they are able to get schlock moving a lot faster, because they're already in the sewage system. A lot of it's luck.
Yeah.
Viral luck.
It is luck. Well, that's what I thought is, I wrote this one, and I'm going to ask for some advice from some people who know the industry.
Yes.
Luckily, I know a couple of people who are in the industry.
And that's the part of the luck. That's the part of it. That's getting those people, keeping them.
It is luck. And I'm just literally just going to, I just want to know which is the best competition to enter into, who's the best person to copyright it with, and then I'm going to let it go and see what happens.
Yeah.
And if nothing happens, it's gone.
It's passed, yeah.
I'll be sitting in the cinema and seeing a trailer for a film and go, this sounds familiar.
Yeah, oh, you don't want that to happen. You don't want that to happen.
Yeah, so like when I contacted you a while back regarding a short film I was putting together.
That's right.
That's an interesting story there, because I wrote a script which the story is very much about suicide and mm-hmm. demons, and I had people interested, really wanting to help me and do this. Until people, I put together, I always put a visual storyboard together, I draw it, and I put music over it and stuff, and then I'll do the voices of the characters, and I make a little video. It's like a little cartoon of this storyboard. And I'd give the script to people.
Yeah,
I'd put the script together, and people had read it, and then once they saw the storyboard and realized how dark it went in areas, people backed away. They said, you can't do that here in Jersey. You can't do that in Jersey. I was like, well, why can't I do this in Jersey? Oh, well, people won't like it. And that's like, really? No. I mean,
yeah.
And that's always angered me, because I've I really wanted, there's a certain hotel on the island which is closed. I went up there to get inspiration to write it. And if I could just get into that one hotel and have a handful of actors, 2 weeks, I'd just love to do it. And once again, it's just when you live in a small place and if you can't get your people to come along with you and just take a gamble on you, just let you do it. Just do it.
And I think it seems as though that Jersey is growing still, right? It's got it's people come and go. You never know.
It's packed at the moment with people. Since Europe opened up, as it were, Jersey's absolutely crammed.
Yeah.
With people, there's a lot of people here. But the short films that are made here, there was a good short film made here. There's another little group called Jersey Film Project, which an artist on the island called Eddie Lumpier put together a group. I got talking to him because he had an idea for a feature film, and pass me a feature film and I'll have a read of it. And he sent it to me, and it was not formatted. It was just loads of words on a page and some descriptions of stuff. So I spent, I'd say, 3 weeks rewriting his script and turning it into a film. And
just formatting it, getting it all straightened up, yeah.
Yeah, I just tidied it up and got it all looking right. It was his story. I didn't really change anything. I added a bit or took a bit away or just tidied it. But really, it was all his work. And he said he wanted to make a feature. We got chatting and got pretty good friends, actually. You know, I'd like to work with him more, but we don't really get to due to everyone having lives.
Yes.
And I met this guy and a guy called Ruben, who's a fantastic cinematographer. So there are these other people on the island, and basically, when I was putting this feature film together, I said to Eddie and Ruben that it's basically to make this. We've only a lot of people, a lot of time to make it, and we tried getting a lot of people together to make this feature film, which was a comedy horror, which everyone always usually goes down at birthday, and and he's still got the script. I think it's got a lot of potential. So it would be nice to see it get made at some point. But I said to him, you know, we need to make more shorts. And during this, I was busy. I can't remember what I was doing. I think it was something to do with Comic-Con or something. I was doing something, and Ruben and Eddie went away and made a little short film called Chaos, which is up on YouTube now. And this little short film is just them two having a play, and it's fantastic. And if people could imagine that there are us, Primavera Pictures and Jersey Film Project. There are filmmakers on the island, and I think there's some potential for something, some absolutely amazing stuff. But once again, as I say, it's the problem with everyone wanting their name in the credits, but not actually helping out.
That's right.
Yeah,
or they're afraid of the material, fear of the material as well. It seems as well for the suicide one.
Yes, but what they don't realise is the suicide one isn't that bad. It is. It's suicide. It's dead. It's dreadful. But it's got a meaning behind it. There's a reason for it. Now I have a feature film, which is more than a feature. I wrote something. I was going through a bit of a bad time myself. And I wanted to write something that I would find every scene in it funny. I wanted something where, you know, when you watch a film, there's always them scenes which let the movie down.
Yes. Yeah.
I wanted to write something that didn't have that, that was dark comedy, but I could push as far as I wanted. And I wrote this a film. Which is it's massive. It's like 300 odd pages. And then I wrote, because I realised I'd never make the film. It's too big. So I wrote a short film, a 15 minute film of the full film. So it's like a 15-minute version of 300 pages. And then I made two sub-story short film scripts. So I've got the domino effect, and then I've got the domino effect shorts, and then I've got the domino matrix and the dominoes down. So I've had a handful of people that have read all the material there, and they find they say it's hilarious, and there's so much there. But the best thing about this reality is, if you asked me to write another short film within the universe, I could, because there's a whole reality going on in there. There's
exactly.
All these characters, and they're all. But the best thing is that you kind of like everyone, but they're all bad guys. There's no good guys, and if you find a guy, you think they're good, and then you find out actually no, they're bad. And
I know what you mean, though. I know what you mean, though, because these characters have such a life of their own. You can put them in any situation. You just think of a situation, you say, okay, well, these characters can still do that, and it's forever expansive, and that's a good that's a good way to lead your characters, because everybody can relate to them then. Thank you very much, Leigh Thorne, for being a guest on this podcast, and I will just let everybody know where you are and where they can find you. It's dax79.com is your website.
Yeah. If you go there, you can follow links to get to anywhere else, because I am on Facebook.
Everything's on there.
Dax79 cosplay, and then there's YouTube, dax79. I mean, if you Google Dax79, I think I own like 3 pages of stuff. So
it's very you do leave totally a paper trail. You've left a trail. That's good, and that's you've left your mark on Google search. So that's it. Yeah.
People always find that funny. If you type in Dax79 and go to Google Images, it's just loads of pictures of me in costumes.
It's
so
great.
It's pretty successful.
And so that's why. Oh yeah. This is only the beginning, Leigh. That's I see good things for you, and I wish you all the luck as well for Comic Con in London. And
okay then.
Okay,
right.
Thanks a lot, buddy.
I'll see you. Bye.
Bye bye.
Bye.
Thank you very much, Leigh Thorne. I never know how to end those. Well, I always seem to say goodbye, and they seem to say goodbye, but the technology seems to just muffle us completely. So it kind of just sounds like we just drift off, but that's the conversation. It was great to talk with Leigh, and I'm looking forward to looking at his work, sampling his work, and seeing more from him in the future. We're not done yet. We're not done yet. We're fighting the fight. We're really looking for people who want to stay to really go the distance. We're looking for creative minds who understand the creative process. We're looking for those people who are enthusiastic to look at other people's work as well. Anyway, I'm out of here. Thank you very much for listening. I hope this rides well, and we'll see if we can make a few more of these soon. Let's not stop at 6. Let's not stop there. There's more than just 6 out there, I'm sure. It's just a reminder, you can catch us on StephenRadford.com and on iTunes as well as YouTube. So please check those areas out. Look for us by name. What are you doing? I know. What are you doing? You want to say hi? Yeah. You see? You know what's going on. Okay. We can do it. All right.